to Beatdown! This year there have been several films about saving the president from terrorists, but this isn't a new thing, as we're about to discover in the alternate, aka Agent of Death in the US. In the grand Hollywood tradition of two similarly themed movies duking it out within the same year, 2013 saw two films which are basically diehard in the White House. The bigger budgeted one was Roland Emmerich's take on the material with its tongue firmly pressed in its cheek, White House Down, with Channing Tatum saving Jamie Foxx's rocket launcher carrying president. But surprisingly, the victor of the pair was actually the lower budgeted but star-studded Antoine Fuqua directed Olympus Has Fallen, where Gerard Butler saves Aaron Eckhart's president from those pesky North Koreans while taking itself slightly too seriously. Olympus Has Fallen was made by Millennium Films, a large independent production company whose chairman is Avi Lerner. Millennium and its sister company New Image has basically rose up from direct-to-video fare to the mainstream and are pretty much today's equivalent to Cannes films. A good portion of that generic action fare in the 90s and especially the noughties came from Millennium and New Image, either featuring fallen stars like Seagal, Van Damme or Slater, or B-listers like Gary Daniels. One of their low-budget action stars was martial artist Brian Gennessey, now turned a state agent, who headlined several of their films like Traitor's Heart, Operation Delta Force 3, and Death Train. Obviously someone at the company liked him because they actually gave him the opportunity to write a couple of his own films such as this one, the other of which, Bad Guys, that Gennessey also directed, appears to have never been officially released. This entry, The Alternate, as it's known in most places, is, you guessed it, one of a million diehard clones in the 90s, and it's about saving the president, and is executive produced by Avi Lerner through New Image. However, oddly, Gennessey doesn't play the hero, he plays the bad guy, with Eric Roberts facing off against him. The film's also directed by notable B-movie maker Sam Furstenberg, a guy who himself moved from making flicks for Canon to New Image, and aside from having a serious thing for ninjas with Ninja 3 The Domination, Revenge of the Ninja, and American Ninja 1 and 2 to his name, he also directed Delta Force 3, Cyborg Cop 1 and 2, and the legendary Breaking 2, Electric Boogaloo. I actually want to take time out to talk about this DVD cover because it's genuinely hilarious. Ignore any man's death down there though, that's just got Ernest Borgnine as an ex-SS officer, and it's just boring junk I won't be reviewing.
Why is it so funny? Well, first off, look at that hilarious tagline, kill the president, kill the hostages, escape. A great idea. That is literally so bad it's good. The White House? Yeah, that's not in the movie. Also, this film stars Eric Roberts and Michael Madsen, as you can plainly see. It also stars Ice-T, but that's not him on the cover. That's right, the bloke who designed this obviously didn't know who he was and put the wrong black guy on the cover. And this wasn't a one-off screw-up, they compounded it by making several variations that still put the wrong photo on the front. Funnily enough, as if to compensate, Ice-T is the only one on my copy's DVD menu despite A, not being the main star of the film, and B, this photo is clearly taken from a completely different movie.
At least the DVD sets the tone for the incompetency of the film itself then. So is Eric Roberts a bad enough dude to save the president? Let's join forces with the officers and find out.
After the film opens with a title sequence featuring dated looking credits and shaky helicopter footage that makes it look at least 15 years older than it actually is, we enter the hotel this film takes place in, where Agent Williams, played by Ice-T, and Brian Gennessey watch the surveillance cameras as the president enters, in this largely empty, gigantic, dark room. Naturally, production design isn't this movie's strong suit. But uh-oh, here comes some party crashers on the floors above, including Eric Roberts. They break into a hotel room as they plan for Roberts to abseil down the building.
Where the hell did that hook lodge into? He fired straight up in the air in which there was clearly nothing but sky until he gets a wooden ledge in the close-up. The only thing it should be lodging itself in is his face when it falls back down again.
William sends his Secret Service men after the intruders.
In this movie, they can't hit a target that's literally 2 feet in front of them. Just because they're on opposing camera angles doesn't mean they're further away.
Williams puts the building on code red as Roberts makes it to the floor and the president reaches the stage, which you would think would mean evacuating the president, but I guess not. Roberts' fellow terrorists suddenly start appearing from out under tables and out of walls. How did they get down there so fast? This triggers full activation, which is to say more armed men and frickin' laser beams. Not that it does bugger all to hell, because almost everyone dies and Roberts ends up assassinating the president. But if you thought the action was especially bloodless, that's because altogether now it was a training exercise. Yeah, I'm sure the Secret Service do this at every place they go to.
Also, if they were firing blanks, how the hell would any of them, especially the guy playing the president, know they got shot? You could very easily cheat like a bunch of school children, especially if you're the guy playing the head of state.
President Fallbrook will be arriving here in 3 hours. It'd be nice if we could keep him alive. This team was brought in here to improve your training. During that last exercise, that window was left open.
I'm fucking acceptable!
Bulletproof glass cannot protect the president.
And the fucking window's left open!
How many kills today?
Wow, these are absolutely, positively the worst Secret Service agents ever put to film. Not only do they blatantly miss an open window, but apparently they've ran through this scenario 4 times now and they still fail? I don't think this is because Eric Roberts is that good, I think it's really because they're just that shit.
Impressed by, wait, hold on, did they cut in too early? It seems like everyone's holding in their start positions. Ugh, anyway, Genesee is impressed by Roberts and asks him to join his team of CIA agents, who are the terrorists in the opening, on a mission, and Roberts is a replacement for a missing member of the group. If you're wondering why I'm referring to the actors by their real names as opposed to their character names, that's because they don't have any. Presumably because he thought it was cool, Genesee is called the leader, and Roberts is called the replacement, not the alternate as the title suggests. Were they worried that people might confuse it with the Keanu Reeves movie The Replacement?
Thanks, but no thanks. I prefer you stay. I don't do requests. Shoot her.
What?
Join us. You can lower your weapon. I know. It's light.
So you have no bullets?
No, I've still got one.
In the chamber.
Prove it.
What is going on with this posturing macho bullshit? I only think threatening to shoot each other before you've even started is the good basis for a solid working relationship. I know this is meant to build up for when they become enemies later in the film, but this is beyond idiotic and completely unnecessary.
On his way to the hotel is President Fallbrook, played by Rollerball's John Beck, who is running for re-election, but he appears to be doing pretty badly considering he has terrible approval ratings, budget-conscious protesters picketing outside the hotel, and he's getting death threats from a mysterious terrorist called Ahmed. I should also mention that his chief of staff, Donaldson, is played by Eric Roberts' wife, Eliza, just as one of the mercenaries is played by Brian Gainsay's spouse, Brooke Thice.
You may find this very interesting.
TV remote?
Not quite. Right there. It activates our eye in the sky and silent alarm system. I'll see and hear what you want me to, sir.
So he has the option to turn off the surveillance camera that's been specifically installed to protect him? Why do you want to do that? If you're guessing that this is a clumsy setup for later, congratulations, you've got some brain activity, which is more than can be said for the people who made this.
This is your escape exit. It's the only one that is manually sealed. Now, once you pass through, it automatically locks you out and everybody else in. You understand?
Why take the time to install what I presume are very expensive lasers? Isn't there something that can do that much more cheaply, like, I don't know, a door with a lock? I hope the taxpayer isn't footing the bill for this.
So Genesee's team get ready for their Black Ops mission wearing the flimsiest disguises ever known to man. What, did they get their fake mustaches from the local joke shop? Also, they got fingerprints to stick on to fool the security scanner. You know, one for each of your 6 fingers. Oh, wait.
If the film's creators don't even know how many fingers someone has on their hand, I'm not surprised they don't know their ass from their elbow when it comes to filmmaking.
The Black Ops team is armed with poisonous knockout blow darts. Yes, really. Obviously designed to get past the metal detectors. There's a really dumb bit where Genesee encourages Roberts to show a loudmouth guest their product, which means it ends up getting examined by security, nearly risking blowing their cover, the idiot.
And why does no one on the Secret Service recognize them? Oh no, they can't be the same guys we trained with earlier. They weren't wearing suspicious looking colored sunglasses.
The event they're all attending, incidentally, is a symposium on world hunger, and it comes with a hefty price tag.
I know what you're thinking. For 10,000 bucks, this had better be a really good lunch.
A $10,000 plate luncheon on world hunger without any irony whatsoever? And why is this president so hated anyway? He just stiffed the rich to cure world hunger. He should be beloved the world over.
It's at this point Genesee launches his attack as his team start firing their darts into the Secret Service agents with laughable accuracy. They even scored direct hits from halfway across the room.
Apparently, a blowpipe and some toothpicks are more deadly and precise than any sniper rifle known to man. Wonder if they spend any time practicing their marksmanship.
Hell, even the armed forces are totally useless against, say, a man charging at them with a table, or a woman half their size despite having automatic weapons. What's more, the lasers actually stop the guests from escaping, electrocuting them. Genesee's team also put on transparent face masks that in no way conceal what they look like as they capture the president. What's with the long noses on them? Are they nosy bonk impersonators? Bizarrely, the film intercuts this with a bunch of rednecks whose home seems much posher than it should be watching this on the news.
Tell me, what is it you want me to do?
Die.
Oh, God. Think they're gonna hurt him?
I'd like to have one of those guns.
Maybe for Christmas, honey.
Well, boy, howdy! I'm a cartoonish American stereotype! All I care about are beer, football, and guns! I'm totally not an ill-judged piece of comic relief!
No! Where are you taking it? Where are you taking it? Die!
It.
Williams has obviously done a really shitty job, even though he appears to be watching the film rather than the surveillance angle. In fact, he's so bad that Eric Roberts sneaks in and darts him unconscious.
Bye, Ice-T! Your character will never be spoken of again! Hope the check paid well.
Speaking of checks, the FBI agent in control on the outside, Briggs, played by Michael Madsen, arrives, surrounded by legions of police stock footage. Madsen, who at the time of this film was only just getting into the direct-to-video bog he's remained stuck in since, has been quoted as saying, "You get these horrifying straight-to-video things for very little money, then you go to the Cannes Film Festival and they got some poster of you 40 feet high in the worst movie in the world. You're like, oh my god, take that fucking thing down."
Yeah, this is definitely one of the worst movies in the world, and judging by Madsen's not giving a shit performance, it evidently didn't pay very well either. So, by that logic, I'm guessing the poster at Cannes at least 60 feet tall.
It turns out Donaldson is actually in on it. In fact, she was the one who set this whole thing up.
"These ladies and gentlemen are CIA. They're Black Ops from Langley.
You deserve to be reelected, and I needed to get you some serious coverage."
"You set this whole thing up."
"For you, sir. To win."
So in order to boost his approval ratings, his chief of staff, without the president's knowledge, hired a team to stage a kidnapping? And one that will surely backfire if the president understandably doesn't comply? This is asinine and nonsensical!
One of the team tries to turn the TV on, unwittingly turning on the hidden camera so Roberts in the control room can see this conversation. Fulbrook fires Donaldson and the rest of the team, but Genesee responds by turning traitor and executing several of his men and Donaldson in the head, which surely should be messier given their automatics.
So the team hired to kidnap the president suddenly turn on their orders when they got real guns? Boy, didn't see that one coming! Our chief of staff really thought things through up until she got herself killed.
Roberts, who is an all-American and is shocked by the killings, immediately gets up and yanks out the power to the coffee machine, pours it out onto the ground and places the exposed wiring in it?
Is that really what your first reaction would be after seeing something like that? Well, as we'll find out later, that's because Eric Roberts' superpower is being able to see 10 pages ahead in the script.
Roberts confronts Genesee and his wife, who tries to bluff his way out implausibly.
"You said the president sanctioned this."
"Mr. President, you are not aware of this operation because it was highly classified, sir.
These two operatives, they're traitors. They're part of a conspiracy.
to assassinate you on the roof during your escape. My real assignment was to discover who was part of this conspiracy, sir. This man is ex-CIA. We believe that he murdered his own family. We believe this man is Ahmed.
Why the hell would the president believe anything you just said? You just shot several people, including his chief of staff, at point-blank range. Especially when you got up on stage earlier and called yourself Ahmed. You're pretty obviously the bad guy.
This turns into a gunfight where Robert somehow manages to hit the other side of the room, slides the president across the table, manages to flip Genese up in the air by pulling the rug out from under him, and the supposedly expert marksmen can't hit each other even when they're using thin chairs as cover or standing still in the open.
Let the president go, I can offer you $30 million. It's a one-time offer.
Okay, one side of that door clearly has three times as many bullet holes as the other side, so this is blatantly two separate locations. Nice continuity, guys. This is almost Art of War 3 levels of gunplay.
Figuring he's outnumbered, Roberts decides to ditch Fallbrook as the two bad guys storm in, shooting out to the balcony and diving off, using a flag to abseil down the building, which he had no way of knowing would be there, much less make a plan. He very, very clumsily manages to get back into the building and survive. Meanwhile, Mary, Gensei's wife, decides she wants some coffee.
What? So Eric Roberts somehow knew the world terrorists would have a severe caffeine withdrawal, go out to make themselves coffee, and apparently not notice the huge bloody pile in front of it with an exposed wire inside it? Even MacGyver would piss himself laughing at this booby trap.
Alas, this president is a dumbass who hasn't figured out who's on his side.
Are you okay, sir?
Is it him? Is he working for Donaldson?
What do you think?
Please, sit.
I said sit the fuck down!
It's you.
It's a perfect plan. Really, my escape's guaranteed. I figured, what the fuck?
You know, despite shooting at him, you actually were doing a pretty good job of convincing the president you were a good guy up until your temper tantrum. And honestly, is this really a good plan? You'd be hunted by every single intelligence agency on the earth for kidnapping the president. It doesn't matter how much money you got paid.
So Genese ties up Fallbrook, and hang on, that room has completely reset itself. That gunfight literally happened 5 minutes ago, and yet there's no bullet holes or ruined decorations, only a few dead bodies.
It's almost like they hadn't actually shot the action scene yet.
Genese discovers Mary's incapacitation. Not that he seems to care much, considering they're the only two terrorists in the movie. Oh, did I mention that he's actually Ahmed the terrorist?
Are you the negotiator?
Yes, I am.
What are your demands?
I demand to know your first name, Agent Briggs.
My first name is Jack.
Jack Briggs, all right?
Jacques. Understand this, Jack Briggs. I will hold you responsible for the life or death of your president.
Did someone tell Genese I sound like a Middle Eastern accent? Because it sounds like a dodgy French impression. Also, if he's Ahmed, then who the hell was calling the president in his limo earlier, since that was cross-cut with him briefing Roberts? He can't have been doing both of them at the same time.
Briggs sends in some commandos on the roof. No, 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 you stupid macho assholes!
Wow, those are some incredibly bad dummies that they chuck off that roof. They might as well chuck bags of potatoes with wigs on top. It'd probably be more convincing.
Roberts enters the security center once more, and obviously electrocution isn't as fatal as it used to be, because Mary gets up and starts clobbering him with a pole. And I think she's really mad about the whole thing, because she hits him over a dozen times in the legs, chest, back, arms, across the neck, in the head.
Seriously, how is this guy not knocked unconscious from all the pole hits he's been getting? Which brings me to another question. Where the hell did that pole come from? Did it magically appear on the floor right next to her?
Naturally, Roberts is spent and Mary's about to kill him with a blade in her lipstick.
Mary, don't play with him! Kill him! No!
Dumbass, you just shot your girlfriend! Then again, he doesn't seem particularly that broken up about it given the week no they just gave. I've had more emotional outbursts while I've stubbed my toe.
So basically we're down to one terrorist and there's a full 30 minutes left. Yep, we're going to be doing a shitload of stalling. Say, Genese, is that a massive gun tucked down your trousers or are you just happy to see me? When he was up on the roof a few moments ago, he went to the president's emergency rescue helicopter and took a flamethrower from out of it, which he uses against Roberts now, chasing him through the empty hotel rooms. At one point, Roberts somehow manages to kick a door in a room, which somehow leads into a corridor that he runs into another room from, or it could just be another air team fuck up.
Why does the president's helicopter have a flamethrower in it? I doubt there are many emergencies where that's required.
Worse, it's clearly a blowtorch attached to a rifle butt, so they had to edit like crazy to cover up the fact that it only has a range of about 3 feet. Remembering that this is a diehard clone, they do not one, but two gigantic steals from that film, combining the bit where McClane dives down the Nakatomi using a fire hose and the bit where McClane tries to go down the lift shaft to create this moment where Roberts uses a fire hose to dangle himself down a lift shaft and evade the flamethrower, as displayed here in constant stock footage.
Ha! John McClane laughs at you, Mr. Replacement! He took on 12 terrorists in one night and he was only a cop, yet this trained mercenary can barely take down 2 people by himself! Best of the best, my ass, Eric Roberts!
Roberts manages to duck into a ratty-looking lift and escape and calls up Briggs. But obviously these two don't have the same relationship that McClane and Powell had.
I'm inside.
To the terrace from the floor above me. Don't do anything stupid, like shoot me.
Who is this?
I'm the guy in the tux.
Okay.
So the only things he said were, don't do anything stupid and I'm the guy in the tux. Not anything about the situation, the condition of the hostages, or even if he's a good guy since they're both in tuxes. Thanks for the useless call.
Genese also calls up Briggs and asks for $10 million in bearer bonds with no catches, which they soon give him. He then does something that defies all explanation. He takes the bodies of all his dead comrades, including his lover, and stuffs them in the president's helicopter. He then gets in and, hold up, it's a fucking toy helicopter. They clearly had a real helicopter, so why is this the exception? Anyway, he goes up into the air and then starts firing at the officers on the ground and lobbing grenades at them.
Come on, you blew up the exact same car twice and just used different pieces of footage. I know you're budget conscious, but I wasn't aware blowing shit up was really that expensive.
Meanwhile, in the ridiculously long amount of time this must have taken, Roberts gets up and frees the president, who calls Briggs to inform he's not on the chopper, telling him to look at the window, and suddenly Eric Roberts disappears through the binoculars. Genese then duct tapes the controls and jumps out of the helicopter onto the roof before the ground forces shoot it down with a rocket launcher. Hilariously bad superimposed explosions away!
Okay, leaving aside the fact that the man just jumped out of the helicopter onto a roof which would shatter his ankles on impact, clearly our villain is taking a page out of Hans Gruber's book and faking his own death. But why the hell did he waste time away from his hostage, pressing around with bodies and blowing up his only means of escaping the building? This isn't cunning, you're a total moron!
The president then acts like an amazing idiot by deciding to sneak off to go see his wife downstairs without telling the guy who rescued him and could protect him. What? And yep, Genese recaptures him, making the last several minutes completely pointless. He takes the president to the swimming pool and plans to execute him.
Why kill the president? He's your biggest bargaining chip! And if you're worried about witnesses, maybe you shouldn't have made threats on TV in a transparent mask, you dumbass!
Roberts then walks in, despite having no way of knowing they were in the swimming pool. They move on opposite sides of the pool, using pillars for cover, where you can clearly see the fake parts used for the squib hits, as Genese starts gabbing on about Roberts' dead family. At one point, Roberts clearly reaches the end of the pool, but in the next shot, suddenly it's either extended itself or he's moved down again. Roberts then gloriously defies the laws of physics while managing to swing like Tarzan on some bunting across the pool, and then gets shot in the leg for it. Yeah, that was kind of stupid in retrospect.
I was paid a lot of money to do a job.
So I ordered you out of the hotel. And the tragic part is that your wife and son, they saw me take out the target. So really, I had no choice. No living witnesses.
Seriously? Did we have to make the bad guy kill the replacement's family? Why do we have to make this unnecessarily and illogically personal? He's holding the president hostage. I think that's bad guy enough.
Luckily for Roberts, is at this precise moment that Genesee has to reload, allowing him to escape. How very convenient! Genesee hustles Fulbrook to the roof, who complains about how he's afraid of heights. Ah, now I know why he's so unpopular, he's a whiny idiot. I mean, he could just take a page out of Roberts' book, who has to climb up the fire escape on his shot up leg, which must be fun for him.
Ahmed,
I want a helicopter! On the roof! Tell them! I want a helicopter.
You already had a helicopter on the roof, and you know what you did? You blew it up, you dimwit! You don't get the right to ask for another one! Your helicopter on the roof privileges have been officially revoked!
The president refuses to comply and chucks the phone off, and it manages to land in front of Briggs despite being nowhere near where it would land, who asks for a chopper anyway. Roberts arrives as Genesee tries to throw the president off the roof.
Lose the gun or lose the president. Now. Good choice.
So you throw away the gun that you could have easily shot him with since you're an expert marksman. Now you got nothing to stop him from killing the president. Everyone's acting like cretins to keep this movie going.
So we get a martial arts scrap between Genesee and Roberts, which is actually quite decently done, even if I somehow doubt Roberts' ability to fight considering all the injuries he's racked up that he now resembles microwave lasagna. He even seems to remember his leg injury, up until he drop kicks Genesee to a lower level.
Okay, one, the arm in the close-up is clearly wearing a jacket, and two, if he jumped onto his already shot leg like that, it would be completely fucked and he wouldn't be able to stand. Aside from that, good going.
He pulls the president up, but here comes Genesee again.
I have a full-auto machine pistol with a 30-round capacity. You have nothing.
You do have one problem.
What's that?
Too close.
Since when did a bit of chain become a whip? Also, why don't you just shoot him? Seriously, every time Roberts gets the upper hand, he does something stupid and throws away his advantage. It's beyond infuriating.
Genesee fires on Roberts, but then decides to throw away his gun for round two. Roberts still gets the upper hand, partially thanks to a gun which only appeared tucked in his trousers when he needed it.
Semi-automatic 9mm Glock, it holds 15 rounds and you still have nothing.
Well, you do have one problem.
Too close?
Too slow. I invented that move.
I never leave one in the chamber.
Too slow? What are you, my older brother? This is just turning into a schoolyard pissing contest now. Just end this already. It feels like it's been going on for the last decade.
Finally, Roberts shoots him like he should have done a billion times earlier, and he falls off the ledge of the building, turning into a particularly floppy dummy as he hits the ground.
Yep, you know what's coming. Oh, I hope that's not a hostage.
So the hostages are rescued, as is the president. Briggs looks on proudly, knowing he contributed absolutely nothing, and Roberts walks off with the bearer bonds, which I think he's more than earned by this point. Rather unusually, the film actually ends with outtakes in the credits, including Michael Madsen goofing around, pretending he's having a shag, his best bit of acting in the whole thing.
Wait a minute. I don't even know your name. What do I call you?
You can call me the replacement.
Actually, I call it the alternate.
Wow, of all the Die Hard knockoffs I've seen, this is probably one of the worst, but it's hilariously bad. Starting out from a laughably dumb premise, the film actually manages to get worse from there, thanks to a script that is simply flabbergasting in the sheer number of idiotic moments. This is compounded by the woeful direction, which is astonishingly bad, featuring unbelievably sloppy continuity and editing mistakes on a regular basis, compounded by an obvious low budget and the deficiency identities are barely even concealed. The sheer lack of terrorists also means the action becomes repetitive and ludicrous. Eric Roberts is at least likable in the lead, above the material, and Genesee seems to be enjoying playing the baddie, but much of the acting is pretty horrible, including some obvious check cashes as Ice-T types his performance, and Michael Madsen lets his shades act for him.
If you're looking for a bad movie to laugh at, the alternate is first choice. If you're looking for a decent action movie, follow the title's advice. Go somewhere else. I'm Matthew Buck, beating down bad movies everywhere.